Now, you're all aware, volume 2 of the Harry and Meghan Netflix docuseries has been released. And in the final 3 episodes, we hear from the couple about what happened in the days following the so-called Megxit scandal. And what happened behind palace doors when Prince Harry met his father and his brother.
It was terrifying to have my brother scream and shout at me and my father say things that just simply weren't true. And my grandmother, you know, quietly sit there and sort of take it all in. But you have to understand that from the family's perspective, especially from hers, there are ways of doing things, and her ultimate sort of mission, goal, slash responsibility is the institution. It was really hard. The meeting finished without any, right, solidified action plan. I think from their perspective, they had to believe that it was more about us and maybe the issues that we had, as opposed to their partner, the media, and themselves in that relationship that was causing so much pain for us. They saw what they wanted to see.
Wow, there is so much to unpack there. And our royal reporter, Gavin Gray, joins us now from London.
Good morning.
Gavin, is this the point of no return? Can Harry and his family ever reconcile?
You know what, Jess? I think it's going to be very difficult. I mean, that was a key clip in the last 3 hours that dropped of that programme. A key clip because he accuses his father of lying. Mm. He says his brother, you know, shouted, screamed at him and effectively bullied him out of the royal family, and also accuses his late grandmother of just sitting there. Now, I don't recognise any of those descriptions about those three people, and certainly nor do the colleagues that I have in the royal pack recognise those descriptions. But there's no attempt at any reconciliation saying I might have been partly to blame, or perhaps something I said misunderstood, or you might have misinterpreted something. Instead, it's just their fault, they were wrong, and that's bad, and I've not received an apology. It's very difficult for him to see a way back now.
Yeah, it's certainly been an explosive docuseries, Gavin. A lot of people are talking about it. But have we heard anything from the palace? I mean, they don't usually comment on this stuff. Is it business as usual there?
Absolutely it is. And in fact, tonight, in a show of strength, they're all at a carol concert at Westminster Abbey, which is being televised as well, organised by Kate. Here they are all arriving. And you can see as well that, you know, there's a whole string of other lesser royals. Here we go in the front row. You've got King Charles and obviously the Queen Consort. But behind Princess Eugenie and Beatrice and Zara Phillips as well. And they're all there. And I think it's this show of strength and show of unanimity. Now, some of my colleagues have been saying, you know, the royals are going to have to respond. The American media in particular saying the royals are going to have to respond. I don't think they are going to respond, at least not anytime soon. And they certainly don't feel they have to. I think there's this underlying hope that Meghan and Harry are slowly blowing themselves out, that the storm will die down a little bit and there'll be nothing new that they can say or add. Time will tell whether that's the case.
Now, another candid moment in the series was Meghan talking about being suicidal. Please take a look.
All of this will stop if I'm not here. And that was the scariest thing about it, is it was such clear thinking.
I remember her telling me that, that she had wanted to take her own life, and that really broke my heart.
I wanted to go somewhere to get help, but I wasn't allowed to. They were concerned about how that would look for the institution.
Now, that's quite a raw admission from the couple, isn't it?
It sure is. Meghan had kind of mentioned this before, but this is the first time we'd seen her mum talk about it. And that is obviously deeply emotional there. And this whole idea that she was banned from getting help, again, lots of people are saying, look, where's the evidence? Who did you ask? Where's the email chain? Or who did you phone? Who was the person who blocked you? Because lots of people can't understand that. Because Harry was encouraged, I think, to talk a little bit about his mental health, to seek help when he was struggling. So why was it any different from Meghan? Now, what Harry and Meghan are saying is, well, it was different because they just thought that's how women in the family, you know, newcomers, as it were, that's how they should put up with it. And if they can't put up with it, well, then tough. But I don't recognise that in amongst the royals. But I have to say that those two parts of this 6-part series really have been, I think, the most serious accusations levelled at the royals. And yet we still don't know, of course, the names of any of the royals that they deemed to be racist, the ones that were asking apparently what colour the skin was going to be. We still haven't learned any more about that.
I know this next part kind of hit a nerve with a lot of people as well, Gavin. I mean, Harry said people were upset about Meghan stealing the spotlight from other members of the royal family, and I know he likened it to what happened with his mother as well. Who would he be talking about there, Gavin?
I think it has to be William and Kate, doesn't it, Tris? I mean, I think that's really who they're talking about there. Maybe perhaps Camilla in there as well. But either way, this is a bizarre accusation. I just think this is a really odd thing to say, and saying that they were better at it, Harry and Meghan were better at being royals than they were, the ones being born into it, that's very odd. Of course, to be fair, Camilla wasn't born into it. Neither was Kate. So perhaps he's referring there to Prince William. I don't know. But again, no names, no sort of backing up of what's being alleged here. And also, Meghan saying that on the plane out after the Commonwealth Day service, her last official function, how a member of the plane crew came over and said, "You've done so much. Your service has been so fantastic." Well, I can assure you, my colleagues and I are desperate to find out who was on board that crew at that day and who said what to whom, because plenty of people are thinking, "Really? Somebody said that to you?"
Well, Gavin, what is the reaction in the UK? What do the people think about the Netflix series?
A term that's become new to the English Oxford Dictionary is whingeathon or wineathon. In other words, lots of complaints, lots of a woe is me, lots of, oh, gosh, this is awful sort of thing. I think lots of people as well saying, yes, where's your evidence? You know, where is the evidence for all of this? Also, people, I think, trying to pick apart some of what's been said. I think some of that actually is a bit mean, you know, saying, well, you said this in Oprah, now you're saying this, and it's not quite the same. Well, you know, nothing outstandingly factually incorrect, to my knowledge, has been identified in this last Black Batch of three. So I think overall we're seeing the British media still very entrenched. Lots of people writing on social media saying that this couple must be stripped of their titles. Lots of people saying they're absolutely brilliant. The royal family should have tried to keep them at any risk. It's interesting, the US media, I think, taking a more cynical tone, though, now. Some actually saying, are these going to be the most unpopular royals for generations? But one thing is sure. Early May is the coronation, King Charles's coronation. Is Harry going to be invited? Plenty of people are saying that would be a mistake, because he will be booed. It's a tough choice.
It certainly is, yeah. Gavin, it's always a pleasure to speak to you. Thank you so much.
Guys.
Happy Christmas to you.
And to you.